Hello everyone, and welcome to Atoms and Sporks. And in this video, I want to talk about our society's crucial, like, technological need for new invisible metals. But what do I mean by that? Well, let's look at a technology that I think it's pretty hard to deny is important to our future. Solar panels. In a solar panel, you have this, like, specially engineered slab of semiconductor material called a PN junction. And if a photon of sunlight enters this special slab, it can be absorbed and excite an electron. And that excited electron can then be collected to give us, you know, clean and renewable energy. But how is this excited electron collected? Well, by sandwiching the semiconductor layer between two metal electrical contacts. These are what extracts the excited electron's energy. As another example, consider something like the LCD, or liquid crystal display, of most televisions, or the OLED, or organic light-emitting diode display, on most smartphones. In both these structures, you have all these pixels, and each pixel is like a little cell with a bottom electrode, usually addressed with something like a thin film transistor, and then you have a top electrode, and these electrodes basically toggle the pixel on or off. Now, solar cells, LCDs, OLEDs, AMOLEDs, and so on are also called optoelectronic devices, meaning they're devices that couple together light and electricity. And looking at it, you can probably spot a pretty obvious design flaw. In our solar cell, in order for light to get into our super special semiconductor layer, it has to pass through the metal contact. In our TV or smartphone screen, light is created either in the cell or provided by a backlight, and it has to get through the top metal electrode to make it to our eyes. So for all these kind of like optoelectronic technologies, we require that light must pass through a metal contacting layer in order for like the whole thing to work. Except, you know, metals are not exactly transparent. But of course, these technologies do exist, so clearly we found clever ways around this issue, and we have. Generally, we do one of two things. The first approach, which is what we usually do with like solar panels, is to just like bite the bullet and use a metal. But we don't have it cover the entire top layer. Instead, we kind of have like a network or grid of metal lines. But this solution is far from perfect, because in a solar cell, the farther an excited electron has to travel to a metal contact, the less likely it is to actually make it there. And that's because it can also lose its excited energy to simply, like, basically heat dissipation as well, which gets us nothing. It just gets us like a hotter solar cell, and its chance of doing that increases the farther it has to travel. So to maximize collection in a solar cell, you want to actually cover as much of the surface area of the panel with the metal as you can. But of course, on the other hand, if the entire thing's covered with metal, then there will be no excited electrons to collect in the first place, because no light ever makes it inside the semiconductor. And it's because of this trade-off that solar panels have to use the highest quality and most conductive metal they can in order to make the most of the metal surface area they have. Which is a problem because the most conductive metal is actually silver, which is not cheap. In fact, silver is so expensive that whether or not a solar panel company can turn a profit can actually hinge not on like their fancy semiconductor design, but simply on the commodity prices of silver, which they need to make the top contact grid. But aside from the price issue, this approach really wouldn't work for something like a smartphone, since we actually have millions of little pixel devices that need their own wires and contacts, and no one wants to look at the smartphone with like an obvious metal grid on it. So there we take a different approach. We use invisible metals. Or, well, I mean, there's a reason I put metals in quotes in the title, which is that it's not actually possible for a metal to be transparent. The same properties that make their electrons very easy to like excite and move means they'll interact with light of any wavelength or color. So part of what it means to be a metal is that you'll absorb or reflect all light and therefore you're not transparent. Instead, we have to settle for what are called transparent conductive oxides, or TCOs. The word oxide here basically means that these aren't metals, they're technically insulators, but amongst insulators, these TCOs are unusually conductive. And if you'd like a deeper physics discussion of what, at a quantum mechanical level, is the difference between a metal and insulator, leave a comment, because that's something we could definitely do. But it's these things, these TCOs, we use for things like our TV or like our smartphone screens. You are almost guaranteed to be looking through a TCO layer right now, unless you're like using like a CRT screen. In which case, welcome to the 21st century. It's alright. And by using these TCO materials, we can make our complex, you know, metal circuitry to address all our pixels. And again, metal kind of in quotes here, and just not worry about it because the TCO itself is transparent and the light can pass through it. But then, I mean, what's the problem? Seems like a perfect solution. Well, there are actually a lot of problems. For one, you might ask, why don't we use these TCOs on our solar panels? I mean, that way we could use 100% of the surface area. Well, there's a few reasons. The first is that by saying something is transparent in our human-centric worldview, we really mean transparent to photons in the spectrum of light that humans can see. And many TCOs are transparent in those ranges, but are opaque in other ranges, and even though humans can't see those other ranges, a solar panel can actually collect those photons. So a TCO may block non-visible photons from being collected by the cell. And the final reason is that of the TCOs we know of, only one has really been found to tick a lot of the engineering boxes we need. You know, there are a lot of design considerations here. Sure, a TCO is conductive, but how conductive? How hardy is it? For example, a lot of TCOs are easily eroded by water or surface contact or decay over time, which makes them a poor fit for a lot of consumer applications. And for all these considerations, the only TCO that has really taken off is indium tin oxide, or ITO. Dollars to buttons, you are looking through an ITO layer right now. And the thing is, this I in ITO is a problem. I stands for indium, which is a very rare material. Strictly speaking, it's not technically rare in our planet, but it doesn't just like show up in our crust with big deposits we can mine. There are no indium mines. Rather, the only place we get indium is actually as a byproduct, an unintended consequence of refining another material, zinc sulfide. In other words, the entire Earth's supply of indium is determined by how much of this completely different compound, zinc sulfide, we make in a year. And that is very quickly going to be a problem. When these optoelectronic technologies started out, using ITO was a good idea. The world made plenty of zinc sulfide, and so there was plenty of indium. But now everyone and their dog has smartphones and like three screens, and there are some up-and-coming solar cells that could make use of it, and we're rapidly approaching a point where we're going to be processing zinc sulfide just to like chuck it in the trash and get the indium. And that, put bluntly, will make all these technologies we depend on way more expensive. And price is everything. You might say, like, fine, it'll cost a bit more, so what? But the only reason we don't have an entirely renewable energy society, for example, is cost. Solar takes over when the cost of the cells and the cost of any necessary storage or baseload technology becomes economically attractive. And in a world of silver or indium-based contacts, that's harder to do. Of course, it's not impossible. Solar prices are dropping every day. But if we could get around this issue of silver and indium, things would be even better. And that brings us to kind of the point of this video. We need new ways of making metal or metal-like contacts that are transparent. We need them for solar cells, we need them for smartphone displays, we need them for TV screens, and that's not even mentioning potentially new technologies that we currently don't have, things like transparent transistors, that we could have if we had more options on this front. So what do we do? Well, there's definitely a lot of hope in the future, and this is an important and exciting field that brings together physics, material science, chemistry, and even in some cases biochemistry to attack a clear societal need. One option is simply to find new and better TCOs. You may have noticed in talking about why we don't use TCOs in like silicon solar cells, how often I talked about drawbacks of the TCOs that we know of. None of these engineering issues are fundamental. There's no law of physics saying a TCO material can never grow well on top of silicon. The issue is simply that we only know of like really three serious TCO material families, and that's just not a lot of wiggle room. And if we knew of more, then maybe we could do more, especially if they didn't use rare materials like indium. The other option is to find other ways to solve the problem. One example here is transparent polymers. Think of something like shrink wrap, or if you're old enough to remember like slide projectors with those transparencies. Those are examples of transparent polymers, but those ones specifically are not very conductive. Those are actually very strong insulators. But there are polymers and plastics that are both transparent and pretty conductive, things like p-dots. None of these are ready for these sorts of display applications yet, but with some work, maybe they could be. There is also another possibility. You see, I wasn't quite telling the full story when I said that metals could never be transparent. You see, opacity is not actually a binary thing, a zero or a one. Rather, the real way to talk about opacity is in terms of what is called an absorption length. When light enters an opaque material, it doesn't like instantly all get absorbed at like the surface. Rather, it dies out over a certain distance, which is the absorption length. The more opaque the material, the shorter this distance is. But I'm sure you've seen something like, let's say, like obsidian or volcanic glass, which is obviously black and opaque, but if you cut it really thin, you see it's transparent. And the same is true of metals. Any metal will be transparent if it's super, super thin. We're talking about like micro or nanometers thin. In fact, the very first solar cell was made in exactly this way. A thin layer of gold was kind of just like spray painted on the top. But if that works, and we've known about it forever, why is this not what we do? Well, because it turns out that metals get substantially less conductive as they get thinner. It's basically because electrons scatter very vigorously at surfaces of metals, which normally is not a big deal when the metal is macroscopically large and the bulk is much larger than the surface area. But when you make it atomically thin, well, this so-called surface roughness scattering causes the metal to become really resistive. So in a nutshell, thin metals are kind of like crappy metals. So that approach doesn't work. So like, why did I even mention it? Well, because there is a material that is atomically thin and thus naturally transparent and extremely conductive. Graphene. Graphene is literally what you get if you take graphite, which is pencil lead, and shear off a single atomic sheet. And graphene could absolutely be used as a transparent contact material. It would in fact be orders of magnitude better than any other material we know. So why don't we use it? Well, if you've heard of graphene before, you've probably heard that it has a reputation for being the most amazing material that can never leave the laboratory and make it to the markets. The main reason for this is that we can't figure out how to grow large sheets of graphene in an industrially scalable way where the final sheets are high quality and not like filled with holes and defects. In fact, when we make graphene devices in research labs, we literally use something called the Scotch tape method, where we take Scotch tape to some pencil lead, peel it off, and search the tape with a really fancy microscope for a single high quality, single atom layer thick flake, and then we just like build our device right there onto it. This works for research devices, but it's obviously not a viable option for consumer mass production. Except, here's the thing. This particular application, graphene as a transparent contact, is probably the most forgiving in terms of graphene's many, many problems. Because even a very, very crappy graphene film would be equal or better than what we already have on the table. I mean, a TCO is a transparent insulator. I mean, it's an okay conductor, but like not a great one. Even Swiss cheese graphene could probably beat that. And pencil lead is way cheaper than silver. So if you're a betting person, you might want to consider that if graphene ever does leave the laboratory, this might be one of the places it makes its consumer electronics debut. And there are also other similar options to graphene. Carbon, for example, can also occur not as a long graphene sheet, but as one that is curled up to make a so-called carbon nanotube. And this might be another option. What we need is a conductive sheet, not a wire, but if you kind of just like spray carbon nanotubes on a surface in a random fashion, like literally with like sort of spray paint, if your spray is dense enough, you'll get like kind of a random tangled network, which will allow conductivity from one side to the other. And like graphene, because these things are only one atom thick, they're transparent. And those certainly aren't all the options, but hopefully it gives you a flavor of what this kind of field of transparent electrodes is and why it's important. We talked about how so many of our technologies have the obvious flaw that light needs to travel through parts in their design that simultaneously need to act as a metal contact. We talked about one way we get around this, using expensive silver grids, and another way, using transparent conductive oxides, or TCOs. We also learned that we don't know of many TCOs, and the best one we have, ITO, uses a rare material that we are about to hit a bit of a scarcity issue with. And finally, we talked about how, in addition to simply finding new TCOs, there could be hope coming from transparent polymers, from the much maligned material of graphene, which even on its worst day could still make a big difference here, and even ideas like spray-on carbon nanotube networks. Anyways, I hope you enjoyed the video. Please like and subscribe if you did, and have a good one.